This video sponsored by Squarespace.
Hi, my name's Johnny, and I used to have a really bad intro.
Hi, my name's Johnny,
and today we're going to be talking about...
Oh, God.
And back when I had that bad intro, I began a series called Pop History, pointing out historical references in shows and media that lasted a whole 2 episodes before, something else kind of took over. But I recently played Bioshock Infinite again, and found something worth making another episode on, I think. And no, it won't be another video on how it represents American exceptionalism. That is something it hits you over the head with, and has been done to death. What I want to talk about is a more secondary group within the game, the Vox. Vox Populi are the game's resistance movement, made up of the working class minorities in the city of Columbia. They are essentially the proletariat rising up against the bourgeoisie, but like many communist-esque factions, also clad in red in other games and media, the Vox are very different in how they are portrayed to the player and how that portrayal image changes throughout the game. At the start, they are very sympathetic. Columbia begins as a somewhat idyllic city. You are quickly shown the dark underbelly that it is built on, quickly making you side with the Vox and their seemingly righteous cause to stand up for the oppressed in the town. This is no more clearly shown than when you visit Finkton, the industrial center of the city, and the slums where the workers of these factories live. They are in extreme poverty, dangerous conditions, and are paid in company store money. Their leader, Daisy Fitzroy, modeled somewhat after Emma Goldman, is even painted as a sympathetic character, being blamed for the murder of the main antagonist, Father Comstock's wife, and has been on the run since. After you help the Vox rise up, though, in a sequence where you fight side by side with them against their oppressors, you end up in an alternate timeline when you realize your character in this timeline was a martyr of their group previously. If you haven't played the game, I know that probably doesn't make sense. I'm not going to go into the timeline stuff for the purposes of this video. Just know that that's part of it. I'll link a good video that explains the timeline if anyone's interested below. And when Fitzroy learns that you're no longer dead, she has the group turn on you, saying,
"My Booker DeWitt died for the Vox Populi. You either an imposter or a ghost. My Booker DeWitt was a hero to the cause, a story to tell your children. You just complicate the narrative."
And after this, you see how the group's actions turn for the worst, beginning a terrorizing free-for-all against the former ruling class of Columbia, culminating in the killing of Fink and an attempted killing of his son. This move from a well-intentioned group to one of terror and the outright murder of the other classes seems to be heavily inspired by many of the communist revolutions you see in the 20th century. During the Russian Revolution, you see the Bolsheviks go from attempting to rise up and represent the worker to the whole-scale slaughter of people in the upper classes and becoming oppressors themselves, just as the Vox do as you progress through the game and into the DLCs. Revolutionaries beginning as ideologists, hoping for a better future, but once attaining power, becoming just as, if not more, oppressive than the people they overthrow. The Vox goes from liberating people from extreme poverty and second-class citizenry to scalping the founders and killing their followers indiscriminately in the streets, as the revolutions in Russia went from peace, land, and bread to revolutionary tribunals. And it takes them from sympathetic to enemy in a way that has to be similar to how a lot of witnesses to the revolution had to feel. You still don't like Comstock and feel for the victims of his regime, but man, these people fighting in the name of those victims have really gotten out of hand, especially highlighted with the Soviets and other members of other revolutions, looking at you, pal, working their way down to killing children of these upper classes from the view that being born into the bourgeoisie class, they would grow up to exploit the workers and could not be reformed. In the same way that Daisy attempts to kill Fink's son, justifying it by saying,
"This is what needs to be done. You see, the founders ain't nothing but weeds. Cut them down and they just grow back. If you want to get rid of the weed, you gotta pull it up from the root."
Although this is retconned and Burial at Sea as being something she is asked to do, which in my opinion completely assassinates her character and takes a lot of the punch out of her and the movement's descent to radicalism, but I guess to the creators, you can't have someone do something extreme and evil. There has to be a plot reason for it that makes them redeemable. And depending on how you read into it, you could, hey, what do I know, fall. Later on down the storyline, there is a timeline, still not going into those, that has Elizabeth waging war on 1980s America, suggesting the Vox were put down and Columbia returned to its former self. This may be because the Vox don't really stand for anything besides revolution and overturning the norm. And after that was done, the movement fell apart. Something that we forget now, as the USSR stood for decades, that at that time, even the leaders themselves didn't know if this thing was going to stick, describing themselves as sitting on their suitcases, being ready to flee if the Western nations decided to come on and attack their fledgling young nation. The West did, but it didn't go well. The demise of the revolution in Russia could have been the same as that of the Vox in the early days. They, however, were able to hold on to power and transition into a non-revolutionary period. All of this to say that it isn't a one-to-one comparison. There is one thing, though, that I do think the Vox get closer to Marx than the Soviets did, albeit a small one. Marx originally envisioned the revolution to be made up of the workers, and that the revolution would come out from the kinds of things that you see in the Vox Revolution that come about in the game. Broadly, poor conditions, treatment of the factory workers in Colombia. Because the revolution would be a result of dissatisfaction within the class of the factory workers, he believed the revolution would break out in a very industrialized nation, as I know he specifically cited Germany, France, and Great Britain to be the most likely candidates. And the Bolsheviks did have to put effort into bringing the peasants into the fold of their movement, as Russia was not that industrialized. And an actual more ideal place for the revolution, at least in Marx's mind, would have been Colombia, being a place where the downtrodden are 100% factory workers, which is more in line with his idea, rather than the rather agrarian Russian Empire of 1917. Not a huge point, but something else that kind of jumped out at me. So that's how I was originally going to end the video in its previous iteration, actually like 3 iterations ago. It's taken a while for this video to kind of form. Just saying that, hey, this is kind of a cool observation. What do you guys think? I think there's some history in it. But then I found a video by a channel called Push to Smart, where, although saying the game's kind of cool, they say that there's kind of a problematic interpretation of Daisy Fitzroy and her movement, in where here's one of the few people of color in the video game who has a pretty justified reason for what she's doing, and instead of having the game treat her fairly, is kind of pushed into this corner as a murderer. Whereas at the same time, your main character that you're playing as is killing people left and right, and it's not seen as wrong. And that her storyline is kind of dropped. And although the game is art, it's up for interpretation however you think, I think maybe the historical analysis is more what the developers were going for instead of just trying to give these characters the shaft and kind of push them away and call them bad for no real reason. As I said, this is oftentimes just how revolutions go. I pointed to the Bolshevik Revolution for my example, but there's any number of revolutions you could apply this to, and I'm sure in the comments people will be pointing that out, and I encourage you to. But instead of relegating the minority characters to kind of this bad area, I think the attempt was more to kind of show how in history revolutions have kind of gone down this dark path, and if there was a revolution of the United States in 1912, because of the power structures in play, it would most likely be minorities that are pushed into being second-class citizens based on systemic issues rising up against a white aristocracy. And just like other revolutions, it very much could have gone the eat-the-rich direction, like it shows in Bioshock Infinite. I don't think it was necessarily any attempt to kind of give these characters the short end of the stick. It's probably just more what they guessed would happen, and they're using history as a backdrop. And I don't think the story is kind of forgotten or dropped. The Vox Uprising is the catalyst for a lot of the problems in the game, starting off derailing you trying to take Elizabeth to New York, although she helps. But then also becoming your enemies, having to fight them all the way through the streets of Colombia. They're definitely there the whole time. Their impact is shown. So I don't mean to make any kind of political statement or anything like that. I really try to keep away from that from the channel. But I think maybe this is a different explanation for why they went in that direction. Kind of a more historically influenced route instead of, you know, something that was accidentally racist. I know that the game director Ken Levine specifically cited the Red Army faction in West Germany as kind of the inspiration for the Vox, and I've mentioned a couple others possibly there. But in my opinion, I think it's a really accurate way of showing just how bad revolutions can go just out of nowhere. That once that little bit of power is attained, it's really easy to abuse it, in the same way that the people rising up had been abused in the years previous. So that's my big conclusion for this video. If you haven't played Bioshock Infinite, I could not encourage you to do it more. It is easily in my top 5 favorite games, up there with Allied Assault. It's got a great story, great characters. I know it's kind of the black sheep of the Bioshock family for some people. There are some kind of plot holes with the whole time travel thing that just kind of comes with time travel media, but it's a really good time. I couldn't encourage you to play it more. Thank you to Squarespace for sponsoring this video. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to build and personalize your online presence, from websites and online stores to marketing tools and analytics. Squarespace is a great focus on the customizability of their product and being able to make your website completely reflect your needs. Building a website with them is really easy, even for newcomers, and offers an almost overwhelming amount of options to change every detail of every page, with a large catalog of starter templates catered to any type of website you're looking to build, from blogs to portfolios that avoid being the same cookie-cutter website designs. You can create your own online business or side project to sell products with detailed analytics on inventory and sales that can connect to your social media accounts for easy sharing of your content. As well, you can set up email campaigns to keep visitors up to date on anything you're working on, such as a large revolution on a city in the clouds. To make your own website, head to squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/potentialhistory and use code POTENTIALHISTORY to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. I'd also like to thank my patrons on Patreon for supporting the channel, some of whom marked on the screen gave me some great feedback on my earlier scripts and really helped the video come into its own. I've been wanting to do another video in this series for a long time, and sorry it's taken so long, I've seen the ass, but I may do some in the future. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you on the next one. I actually named my cat Booker DeKitt after the game's main protagonist, so kind of a big fan. As always, let me know what you think down below in the comments and other revolutions that I may not have heard of that you think this applies to. And thank you all for watching.